Sir, for the record, pwede pong ma-state yung full name niyo and your faith background?
Teofisto Guingona Jr. I'm retired. I have served many years in public service, both during the martial law years as oppositions. Former detainee. Chairman of the Commission on Audit, and then Senator, after that I became Executive Secretary, Department of Justice, Department of Foreign Affairs, Senator and Vice President. So, retired, but not tired. Continue to play, read, and join rallies whenever appropriate, and I'm ready for your questions.
So, thank you. When was the first time you ever went to Mendiola to join a protest action?
Before martial law, just during the heydays of the first quarter storm. They asked me to join. I joined. But that's not the first time, nor the second, nor the last time.
Were you in government then?
No, I was in I was a constitutional convention in 1971. Elections of 1970. That was the height of the first quarter storm. And so Mendiola was already becoming a symbol because you had Netanyahu, which was the symbol of power. And you had Mendiola, which was a symbol of resistance and freedom. Warning against abuse of power. And around Mendiola, the colleges, the scholar, the spirit. And therefore, this is a place that was duly marked. It was Mendiola. Let's go and fight freedom. And one of those who used to go there was Chino Rosas, and very fittingly, he was the bridge was named after him, and he was by Chino Rosas, Chino Rosas, Tanyana, the old man. So that kept on until now. As a matter of fact, there was a plan during martial law to acquire all of that for Malacañang.
The entire area?
The entire area. There was such a plan, but there were objections from the colleges. I could have pushed through that. We would have been on the outer fringes of Skarga.
Who broached the plan?
With some members of the Matagal security. Why should we be harassed by the students? you know, they went as far as the bridge, not only the bridge, but beside the church. They crashed through the walls I don't know which gate that is. They opened the three times. It looked like a revolutionary scene. So the plan did not materialize. So usual scenes, these horses in India, these in Italy, and necessary banks in the back. Students, people passing. So that's it. It's a symbolic and actual background. But it should not be. It should be a scene of peace, academic progress, and where the people who govern are in unison with the people who are governed. It does not have to be confrontational. As long as the perception is that there is good governance and the rights of the people are respected. But that's it. First 2 years of martial law, after that. First quarter service before martial law.
Yes.
Then martial law was declared. The week of habeas corpus first, martial law. And first 2 years were relatively peaceful because one of the objectives, declared objectives of Mr. Martin was to change society. And there were a number of Filipinos who wanted change. That's what we need, that's what we want, change. It was a different kind of change, not the one that they wanted.
So, during those first 2 years of martial law, there were no protest actions, or you were not involved in any protest action that leads to either?
I don't really know much, because I was January of 1973, instead of rallies, there was a campaign because there was this constitutional change. You know, there was a constitutional convention, and then they allowed the convention to go ahead, jailing some delegates. Then the finished product, they finished
the constitution,
and then presented it to the people. First it was supposed to be a real plebiscite, but then because of the strong opposition, we resorted to assemblies.
The barangay assemblies.
Hey, nung gusto kumain, asan kumain?
That was it.
So, and that things quite down, of course. Martial law was something new. There were people who wanted to watch and wait. As a matter of fact, the rallies did not really take place during the martial law. Demonstrations left and right, guerrilla tactics, but nothing massive nor organized. So it was still the festive stage. For 2 years, we flaws in the cracks in the implementation of change began to show. There was selective justice, there was selective implementation, some could travel, some could not. And so, that's why I say that the opposition itself really began the first day that Marshal Law was declared, when so many innocent people in jail, taken away, salvaged in the night during the first few days. Then it was only in the latter portion when this triggered by the elections first 5 years of martial law, one election. So Marcos has always been humorously or seriously pressured. You say there's democracy in your election. So he decided the election. He went to Manila. Ninoy, who was in jail, sent a message to us, let's fight. So that happens. So, coming to the old man Dañada,
you were out of jail by then?
I was in jail. I did not want to participate initially. I said, let's boycott. But then Ninoy convinced us. Hindi man tayo arrestuhin, kahit arrestuhin tayo, sige yun.
Well, but you were aware that the election could, you know, be a farce only.
Yes, of course, it was a farce. But it allowed us to go to the people who have an excuse for them to assemble, to have an occasion to tell them the truth. It took a while. Doon sa pag-umpisa namin, Las Piñas, dating ko, parang walang tao. Barangay natin, hindi mo wala, ayaw sa mga ay sa yung mga bata rin, lalaro rin. Ay, anong gawin natin? Tuloy natin. Ay, tuloy. Para kaming gagawin. Speaking to a crowd, non-existent, children play. Sometimes we stress upon children, then they play again. First, Las Piñas, and then Paranaque.
These campaigns were basically directed by Ninoy, or were there a group?
Ninoy was in jail.
Yeah.
So we had 15 brothers-in-law. So there we were. Second week, mayroon lang kung punta. Because in Las Piñas, nakita namin ilang tao nga ang mga bahay, pero sumisilip doon sa bentana. Nakikinig. Di animado kami. So, second week, mayroon na. Tapos dumadami, tuwing meeting, dumadami. Until by day, it became a real mass meeting. And the people were, kamayan. And we were exposed. We would tell them how much the nuclear plant costs, how much, magkano utang ninyo. Yung mga ganon, ganon ba na? So, in the beginning, the general campaign manager, Lorenzo M. Tagada, and he told us, alam niyo, under Marcelo tayo, pagka-diktador, walang mananalo kontra si diktador. Pero,
dinala niyo po ba sa mga probinsya yung mga meeting?
No, this is region by region. Metro Manila, the whole of Metro Manila was...
Here in Metro Manila, saan po yung mga pinakamalalaking lands? Yeah, lands.
In all municipalities and cities, the Sin City, Manila, Mandaluyong, San Juan, lahat yan. And we really, really, this was, that, as I said, by the moment of study, big, massive. And sweat by the time, one of them told me, partner, ang dami ng tamo, kung mananalo na tayo. Ba, nadinig ni Tani. Basta sige lang, he knew he could not win. And he threw now.
Yes.
The campaign was much pushed back by Ninoy. So they had a television. Si Ninoy nasa loob ng labas yun.
Mm-hmm.
Si Mille nasa labas. Debate sila. Over television. And people watch. Very good. You know, for now, of course, the smugglers in Salinas, you know, I see Johnny, easy car. So, that was it. But when the results came, we won the election but lost the counting. Talo kami sa bilangan. So, Ninoy, and all our candidates, they've lost. All the candidates of Lella won. Lella won.
Sa tingin niyo po ba naisip ni Marcos that it's an opportunity, in fact, for the opposition, even though manalo sila sa election?
Oh, yes.
So, may retaliatory steps po siyang ginawa after the election against the opposition?
Yun lang, during the election, the eve of the election. Alam na namin na talo. Si Herman of the Pomalekos, and Rich, Senator Perez. So, ang ginawa ng opposition rally ay the noise barrage. Ito parang New Year's Eve. Almost a whole night, up to 2 o'clock. And I understand that Asigri Pumarco, one of the guests was telling me, he was in a social gathering. And when the Miss Baraj came, he joined and he tapped his glass.
So it cuts across all classes?
All classes. Rich, poor, left, right.
Then after that, what happened to the opposition?
Mendiola was not the focus there.
Yeah.
Because that was the campaign all over. Congo.
Trying to bring the message there to the people. Now they didn't have one focal point.
Yes. This Alex Bungkayao.
Yeah.
Alex Bungkayao was with us. And we did. Short fellow. Bomba ng bomba. That's why Alex Bungkayao will give it.
Yes, yeah.
And, during this lady who ran for mayor.
Sorry, good plans.
Plans. She does. So, Rigo. Mitra, Nene Pimentel, Joker was a lawyer. So that was the height of opposition. And that was my name. Now, from that time on, Pana, Ibana. So we lost the elections, but in the minds and hearts of people, Ibana. So, Ninoyos, 1980, 1981. He got to undergo surgery then. Balik niya ako, 1983, he was shot. That,
values ko, yung values back. Natakot pa rin. The center became happy because business through certificates, buildings, showing support. Businessmen who the workers were to join, and the businessmen themselves were participants. So the church joined already resistance.
Was that the first time that Makati became a place of protest? If we backtrack from martial law to your student days, how significant was Mendiola as a place of protest? Or was it more Plaza Miranda or Liwasan Bilipa?
I don't know, I cannot tell. It became significant also. But the first quarter song is what started. After that, there were rallies in Mendiola. Stop for the police. But the resistance grew not only in hearts and minds, but in numbers. So when the thing between Ramos and Julia rocked to ally themselves, some civilians thought, but most of them needed the board of Karikansin. Voluntarily went to exile.
Nasurprise ba yung opposition with Ramos and Andrew Smith? What were your scenario then?
Yeah, we heard about the disappointment of Ramos. We thought anything he would be carried to. He did not think about was a very hard thing to serve. But as it turned out, his fellow Lupin, Bobby, was the one who told him, he's blaming me for this. And so he was grappling with the old drama. That was Saturday, we had a press conference. Started. But that was for 4 days. And within 4 days, he was calling and exchanged their attempts to catch up. My question, you will be restored to the Secretary of Defense. Chief Pisao, he was vice chief. And what about the men? Well, you cannot just let them go right away. After a while, but you come back, that's the main thing. It's too late for them. They transferred him beyond the program, where they had the medication. Contacted all the forces under him. He was former PC chief. So, walang kurbanya, calling for support. civilians in the meantime. There were some tax builders, but nothing sustained. And tax of General Kadia came. So that's what happened.
And from EDSA, I believe there was a march up to Malacanang. Was that part the?
Hindi na ako yun, hindi na sa organized group. There were people who were storming the
So, on the part of the opposition, was trying to manage the people, the crowd, there was no explicit decision that let's march to Malacanang.
There were plans, there were suggestions, but we did not know. We didn't tell the people, only the people trying to interact. Corey was officially in school, and because of her absence, the military was already planning to But on the advice of some mid-Sunday afternoon, she was here and she went to Elsara. It was all very bad. No, she was the plunger bad because of me knowing Jesus was a symbolic figure of Minoy's continuous resistance. And she was the candidate to stop elections. She lost. We mounted under all the opposition of boycott, like announcing Moralco at the time, it was held by Wonders. No, no, not buying from Express. And
you were part of that group that basically supported Tony from day one of her presidency. How did you react when you found out that nandun na yung mga tao sa Malacanang and well, there were reports of looting and rampages inside the palace?
Well, it's like there were teams sent from the hero.
Were there military teams or?
Partly military. Civilian. Local from the Congress, she took the office. Exodus, the initiative came from civilians.
So really good,
Hindi military. The military came and so forth. And because Hera did not use police, nor the military, to suppress. President, is learning from the lessons how to avoid those things. Because in the beginning, once the circumstances were in favor of those who wanted to change the course, there was a blue ribbon. Building in the Senate, where the signatures for impeachment were being little around very minimal, giving only 20 something. The hearing was started Guinness on it. And because the prosecution was started, they had the defense. So the people were hearing only the side of the prosecution. Men were not hearing the side of it. Until the second envelope became an issue, whether to open or not. Well, the senators had to vote in the beginning. Yung natalo, 10, 11 versus 10. 11 for not opening, 10 for opening. So, when the Senate follows the case to acting again, answer again. Not so much of Mendiola. Later, I think it was some. It was March.
Yes. So, during the first few years of the Aquino presidency, nangyari yung Mendiola massacre. And by the time we had the negotiating panel, what was the impact of that?
We took all of the meeting.
How did you learn about the
through the radio, the media. We were all taken aback. We were in the midst of trying to reach an agreement. The number of deaths, the investigation of the committee that was before suspended. Silent.
What could have been achieved had the Mendiola massacre not happened? What were you trying to do?
Well, that was a time for unity. Mm-hmm. And what we wanted was, sharing, explain to the structure of government. You cannot share anything that is outside of the government. It's selective. It's only appointed. I think after human rights,
there were some people who insinuate or sinasabi na sinadya ang Mendiola massacre. How did you feel that particular event? I mean, being in the negotiating panel.
Well, I thought it was an unfortunate happening. Something that happened to many people. Really shocked at this process.
When that happened, were you involved later on how the Aquino government should respond to the event, on crafting the message, the strategy, and how to deal with that particular event?
Yes, but only in the form of short advice. I was already in the Senate. Mm-hmm.
During your time as senator for Pilipinas, were you involved in any protest in Mendiola? Or you were strictly a member of the parliament, so you shied away from those protests?
No, I did not join any protests anymore. As a matter of fact, I could not hold on to my own roots. Because I did not want to be burdened by the sustaining horses that were not on the table. We had so many things going. And
COVID?
The first step was also I remember in the first year in 1989. To the task, military funding. And this one is 1989. I remember when the senator telling us, Kakao Pulang ng Matin, hindi pa mailit ang puwit. Alisin na tayo. But that was a wake up call. So, the only changes in EBSA were not really handled adequately or fully like changes in the military thinking.
From the Senate, eventually you became an executive secretary of President Ramos. Right?
Yeah.
And then you went to Justice.
I went to Justice.
Wait an instant, sa mga pagkakataon din nasa post kayo na yun, that you have to deal directly with how to handle Mendiola. O may protesta, o may
gulang.
Because now we usually have this image of the Justice Secretary issuing pronouncement on who can rally, who cannot. So there were no explicit pronouncement of how rally should proceed.
Rally should not be called a day. What was uppermost in the whole Secretary of Justice? Yung Disponde Massacre.
Yeah.
Alos Cross. No, no, no. Those are the ones that took the limelight. Not ZPE.
So, then after that, of course, when you became Vice President and the Foreign Affairs, and you had the falling out with Gloria.
Yes.
And then there's this image of you getting pushed down in Mendiola. Was that the February 14, 2005? That really bothered the nation. How did you end up being there?
Well, that took place October
15. Okay, sorry.
October 14. Yeah. I remember that process more nervous, but I was invited by the bishops and the members of the Tungkay Pan, the younger.
You were with Satoru Kambo and those
people. Yeah, and Jambi Nabigal and Dick Orbos.
Kita sa mga kabayan ka rin sa
KMD. To speak at a prayer rally. So I went. Mendiola lang na. Ano yung Mendiola?
Where did you gather first?
First in Miranda.
Plaza Miranda.
From Plaza Miranda, we had prayer rally talaga. Prayers during the Mocha. San Sebastian. San Sebastian. We're going to San Pedro. Doon sa Claro Recto. Yeah, I spit at the lamp with my left leg. I think it was a sprained or
anong damdaman niyo noon? When the water is struck you?
Just a continuation of what what I experienced here in Marshall. Absolutely. We were beaten, we killed gangsters, every time. Okay, now, the policeman, after the katapos na ng thing, and some of them were apologetic. One of the specialists from Mindanao. He's also a member of the Mindanao.
How did you react to the apologies?
I knew that whatever the doctor was saying is true. But we cannot explain to them that kailangan na a legal order. What you obey should be a legal order. If it is a legal command, may karapatan kayo, hindi sumunod. Very hard to explain. So, I was told them that we are fighting for a just cause, for peace, or anything. So, that's the way, and then, added to the Mendiola.
I think you were the first vice president after that was done in Mendiola.
Canonized,
yes, that's how you put it in the media. Yeah.
So, ganon, until today, the struggle continues because all of these cases that have been decided by the Supreme Court are not really honored by the executive. The calibrated preemptive response is declared null and void. But still, the policemen are so morally, this is contrary. Mendiola itself is supposed to be, which one is the freedom factor? That should be declared already, freedom factor.
Why do you think the present administration is so adamant in protecting that space, in controlling that space?
Because if it's breached, you cannot control the crowd. And I don't know, I think they have acquired sophisticated weapons now. The crowd in the first part is so able to break through the door. I was out of the country in that early morning of May 1st. Serious threats.
You were vice president then. Yeah. I know it's a press. And then, how did Gloria respond to that? I mean, were there a cabinet position? Was it discussed?
Yes. Emergency crisis committee. The main thing is the borders of Scotland.
How?
In fact, several people were victims, members of the Ignatia.
So there was really an explicit order to use force?
Yes.
To contain the crowd? If compared EDSA 1, EDSA 2, and the May 1 effort, also labeled as EDSA 3, how would you evaluate this last one?
EDSA 1 is the most, had the most impact. Because the people went there voluntarily, went out, fear of their preservation is something aside. Just to see, just to make sure that there is a change. Here in Guala, they got food along the stable. And you could see the dedication, it was a sweeping, massive people power. Instead of, okay, I was not here during the executive, I understand.
So, was there a consensus really in the cabinet that it's okay to use force? Or was it just the order of the president? How what's the deliberation?
There is another cabinet meeting, it's a crisis
management. Were you part of it? When you learned about what the decision of the, did that create a tension on how the May 1 rally was handled?
I came in May 1. Yeah.
And then you learned about the casual abuse. Mm-hmm. How did you react?
Well, I question. How did you? It's already done, finished. Energies, compensation. I don't know how true this is. Because we were fueled and drink in the cloud. Really dividing the world. I believe that we have a good one, the Filipino, a Filipino student. And if you're a Filipino traveling, they will take time off because they can be more.
In hindsight now, why do you think people keep on going to Mendiola? And will it continue?
Yes, because that has become symbolic. Symbolic for people's resistance to abuse, oppression, against truth, justice, injustice. And therefore, continue, but there is some such a thing as fight all the time. Sometimes you have to relax a little because but not circumstances now it's full of crisis. What did you rally about? And did you put the power? Ibang kone, ibang values na. Well, the government must show that they are hungry.
Handa pa po ba kayong bumalik ng Mendiola, given particular issues or the right circumstances?
I think I still can.
Sir, thank you. That's the last question. Thank you.